Welcome to a phase four opportunity as we practice this intensely active passivity, which is full stop in the burn. The more we practice this, the better we get at it. The better we get at it, the better transmissions we can receive. Okay, so it's a win-win positive spiraling here. Very much so. It is both active and passive. The activity is to hold oneself in the passivity, okay, in the choiceless awareness, in the simple full stop in the now, full stop in the burn, full stop in the now, full stop in the burn. There will be this burn for sure. As we refuse to structure absurdity, and in fact, structuring absurdity is the absurdity. It's not absurdity and then a structuring of it. Structuring absurdity is the total absurdity. That's how it arose. Let's structure absurdity. Two sides of one coin. So we will say we are not going to engage in structuring absurdity. That is the absurdity. Full stop in the burn of that. Now, what is the benefit of doing this way? By the way, this is impersonal. We're not fostering a personality cult here. This is impersonal. This is not a dialogue. This is a transmission. It's an opportunity to practice full stop in the now. As you refuse to structure absurdity, you will feel this agitation arising. And you just have to use your spiritual will. Be very active with your spiritual will, saying, no, I'm just going to let this burn happen and it's going to evaporate. This is the fast track. In order to have this fast track, you need transmissions. Okay. So, I've certainly spent a great deal of my life listening to these transmissions. Transmissions from Jesus, transmissions from Ramana Maharshi, transmissions from Nisargadatta Maharaj, transmissions from Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, and transmissions from various sources. Just listen. Or just reading and just hearing it. One has to hear it. Okay, I guess listen is not the best word. Hear it, truly hear it. When you hear it, then this agitation arises, this consternation arises, because what you're hearing seems to be melting or evaporating your reason for existence, so to speak. And in some ways it is, but it's more than that. It's more than that. So this sort of leap of faith is required in phase four, but you've already made it. If you're here, you've already made it a basic leap of faith. And that is, it's not evaporating our reasons for existence. It's showing us that nothing has ever existed. This is very different, isn't it? It's not like, okay, we rid ourselves of some problem of existence, and now we can have a happy existence. It's not that we're free, get free of existence. That's duality. It's that we recognize, their ultimate recognition is, there has never been any existence whatsoever. There's always only been just the oneness, without a second, without an opposite, without a top or a bottom or inside or outside, just the totality. There's always only been just the totality and nothing else whatsoever. So one should not be concerned about an interaction with somebody, interaction with a teacher, or interaction. It's a quiet, silent sitting, hearing, a hearing of a transmission. And this requires all of the attention and effort and act you can muster to keep yourself in the hearing mode, instead of shifting into the listening, I would say. The hearing is you're getting it, and you're just saying, oh my gosh, this is true. Nothing has ever existed. Nothing has ever happened. Nothing's ever existed. Just there's only the one. That's always been the case. And inside, you're just, you know, you got the cold sweats. You're just, whoa, it's a revolution inside. This is the true revolution. The true revolution we're looking for is exactly this. Transmission of truth, the hearing of truth, the full stop of this hearing in the now, the full stop in the burn, the ordeal of the burn, full stop in the now, ordeal of the burn. Because you will want to do something about it. Reassert existence. And you use your spiritual will. You say, no, I'm just going to keep sitting here. And we hear that all these positive goals that existence just seems to be pursuing, this is a trick. Because existence is saying, hey, I want to perpetuate life. No, life is a dualistic concept. Life actually is trying to perpetuate death. And death doesn't exist. Neither does life. There's only the oneness. There's neither death nor life. We say we want to perpetuate the light. What we're really doing is bringing up the opposition to the light, which is darkness, you see. But the truth is there's neither light nor darkness. There's only the oneness. There's only the totality. And hearing this, it puts us into this funk, you know, just a freak out almost, just wow. But it is completely manageable as you actively use your will to full stop in the now. You're not acting on anything that arises. Now, every day you may think, oh, okay, I got it. And then you hear it again, the ache is there. It's like, oh. Yeah, it's because it's you're getting it more profoundly, actually. Way more profoundly than you might be aware of. This morning I checked out the whole issue of chaos and relaxing beyond the supposed chaos. And I didn't feel any fear. I didn't feel any fear at all. I just said, oh, okay. I hear what Longchenpa is saying. I hear what Jesus Christ is saying. I hear and I'm feeling it, you know. It's getting into like an acceptance. It's going towards acceptance. And from that perspective, there can never be such a thing as chaos. And again, never struggle with concepts as you full stop in the now. Don't struggle with a concept. You hear something, just hear it. That's it. And as you do that, that is your progress, actually. That is your progress. Because confusion is strictly a result of the continuity fear. It's the continuity fear trying to cure confusion with confusion. And of course we know that that cannot be done. It's an absurdity. We cannot cure absurdity with another absurdity. And the lack of clarity that we're seeing is from the continuity fear. So the way to evaporate the continuity fear, and you'll see the situation as it is without conceptual struggle. It will be a total, holistic, total view wherein there is no struggle with concepts. So do not struggle with concepts. Refuse to struggle with concepts. Confusion, that's confusion trying to clarify confusion. What we are getting ready for is self-evidency, total self-evidency, total self-evidency. That's already the case. It's already the case. We wanted to establish a separate reality with a new foundation. The foundation that we have tried to use is total chaos. And then therefore, anything less than total chaos, in contrast, seems to have what we call order or life. So we tried to create a new life separate from God's creation based on a foundation of total chaos. But as Longchenpa is pointing out, this is where he's supremely helpful. There is no such thing in relation to pure spaciousness, zero dimensionality. There is no chaos at all. There is no chaos at all. So even this dream of chaos is perfectly contained, effortlessly, flawlessly contained in the now. This is where we're going towards. This is what we're getting towards. When we can relax into this realization, then we will truly be free. Because chaos is the supposed new foundation of a new creation. Okay. And this existence of what we think a world, we think is built on that foundation of chaos. And yet when we see there is no chaos, we also see there is no world. There's only the oneness, only the perfect oneness, the totality. The totality is not affected in any way by any flow of appearances, by any coincident appearancing. It has no effect. This is what we're going towards, and we can get there. I've already felt a tremendous progress checking in and saying, yeah, it is working. It's a little fly here. It is working. And so I continue. I know that it works. And I know that this is working. It's really the fast path, which is what we need. September 11th, 2014, the 13th anniversary, we now have declared a all-out campaign. And events are unfolding exactly as it's been shown that they will unfold. It's no surprise at all. Disappointment? Yes, no surprise. No surprise. So, we have to have a campaign of our own, a campaign of realization. And this ultimately, it is relaxing beyond the chaos, which is the supposed foundation of a new creation. And when I say nothing ever happened, that is true. Everything that we think is happening is only a contrast to what we think is total chaos. But in reality, there is no contrast. There is no contrast. There's no meaning derived from contrast. There's no meaning derived from motion. There's no meaning derived from location. I am confident that the relaxing beyond this supposed chaos is possible. I have no doubt that Longchenpa did relax beyond this supposed chaos. Jesus Christ also, for sure, has relaxed beyond this. Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma has always been relaxed beyond this. Beyond is just a term we're using. And others, like Sri Nisargadatta, Ramana Maharshi, etc. And actually, there have been many throughout history. So for sure, it is possible for us to relax into the absolute totality without any trace of chaos or structure or time, space, process, location, determinacy, without any trace of any of that, traceless, baseless, groundless, no determinate self, to relax into this plenum, an absolute plenum of pure blissfulness, pure oneness. We absolutely can do this. And we must have a campaign to do this now. We must have a campaign. The world is on the warpath. The world is on a campaign in more ways than we realize, actually. The world is trying to structure absurdity, okay? It's fanatically and absurdly, it's absurdly engaged in the absurd attempt to structure absurdity. And in doing so, it loses all balance. In an attempt to get into balance with imbalance, it loses all balance. Becomes fanatical. Fanaticism has many faces in this world right now. So we do have a campaign. It's a very active campaign. We're actively engaging in this great passivity. They say peace starts with us, right? With each one of us. Each one of us needs to look in the mirror. Peace starts with us. Practicing this great passivity. It is not timidity. It is not submission. It is not passive aggression. It is none of those things associated with the nature body, with the genders, the nature genders, the nature body, the nature world. It is an act of spiritual will. It doesn't come from nature at all. Nature body, nature gender, nature world. No. It is an act of spiritual will. And is actively, I'm saying, I'm going to be passive in the face of what I am hearing. I'm not going to try and structure it at all. I'm simply going to let it be as it is. Simply going to let it be as it is. This is not a nature attitude at all. It's not a nature attitude. In fact, we are not bound by nature in the slightest bit. In fact, there is no nature. We are spirit, we are free, we are still exactly as God created us to be. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me to be. We are not creatures of nature. In fact, nature, as we are wishing it, believing it, doesn't exist at all. Has no basis in reality whatsoever. And yet we have these beliefs and attitudes based on the belief. We have a continuity problem. So we must use our will to refrain from allowing the continuity fear to drive us into rationalization, which it most certainly will do if we don't keep a very tight, close watch on it, very active watch on it. That's just full stop, full stop. We all have this quality that we're exercising of attempting absurdity. And we need to bind this, so to speak. We need to use our will to say, no, full stop. We are not going to indulge this tendency at all. This is spiritual will. Okay, so I will read at random. some of this transmission from our city for expression and evocation into producing the burn and challenging us is extraordinary. And of course, the ego insists that it's actually more interested in spiritual truth than we are. And the only reason that we don't think so is because the ego is waiting for the Messiah to come. The ego is always waiting for the Messiah to come up, the Savior to come. And the ego is always insisting that when the Savior gets here, the ego is going to embrace it, of course. The thing is that the ego's Messiah never arrives. And the ego is always insisting that whatever has already come, the outlets of truth that have already appeared here, the ego says, well, yeah, they're good, but it's not good enough for me. I need something stronger. I don't need this weak stuff. I need something really strong. And so they never actually get started on anything. This is a fact. This is called self-righteousness. The self-righteous are always posing, like they're spiritual posers. And they're saying, yeah, I'm just waiting for the real heavy stuff to come around, and then, you know, because that's what I need. This other stuff is not heavy enough. It's not good enough. It's not deep enough, you know, whatever. And they maintain this self-righteous posture that those who, you know, they're not going to settle for second best or something like that. Remember that the outlets of truth simply transmit the truth so that we can practice this burn, full stop in the burn, and evaporate our resistance. Okay, so we're the ones who are supposed to be doing this practice daily. We're not supposed to be waiting for some future Messiah, some future Savior. There have been many, 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 many outlets of truth show up in this world. Okay, take your pick. Whatever brings this burn, whatever just brings you, you know, pulls you beyond duality, actually, that will produce this burn for sure. And there have been many outlets of truth, actually. Okay. And the ego's always saying, well, I can't decide which one, blah, 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 blah. It's nonsense. That's absolute. That's all continuity fear rationalizing. Okay. There is always a teacher, an outlet that you can tap into in this world every day, even if it's within the Holy Spirit within, you see. There is always, it's always that way. Therefore, there's never an excuse. And any given day, never an excuse not to be engaged in intense inquiry, intense full stop in the burn, full stop in the now ordeal of the burn. There's never an excuse. The ego always is making an excuse in a self-righteous way. Always. So we must turn away from that. That's absurdity trying to cure absurdity, confusion trying to cure confusion. And we know that doesn't work. And we know we must clear this up, so we must do what works. It's that simple. Okay. So we will say this, not for the point of intellectual discussion, not for the point of the activity of listening, but for the purpose of actually hearing it and just saying, wow, I'm not yet aligned with that. Wow, or I need to align with that. Wow. Whew, wow, it's a burn. Okay, so with that in mind, and with all the grace overflowing always in the present moment, supportive of this endeavor, this is what works. Since luminous mind excludes nothing whatsoever, so all experience is of the nature of luminous mind. Since luminous mind excludes nothing whatsoever, so all experience is of the nature of luminous mind. Is of the nature of luminous mind. The simile for luminous mind is sky-like, because that mind has no cause and cannot be objectified. It has no location. It is ineffable and beyond ideation. It has no location It is ineffable and beyond ideation. So, quote, the spaciousness of the sky, unquote, is an apt metaphor. If the metaphor denotes nothing specific, how could it evoke anything definite? Understand that the sky is a metaphor for natural purity. What is evoked is the sky-like intrinsic presence of luminous mind, incapable of verbalization, defying illustration, all right, and description. Very important. Let's go over this again. Incapable, luminous mind, incapable of verbalization, defying illustration and description. Such is the vast matrix of intrinsic clarity, motionless, clear light, intrinsic clarity, motionless, clear light, intrinsic clarity, motionless, clear light, uncontrived spontaneity without status or dimension. Uncontrived spontaneity without status or dimension. It is the Dharmakaya, which is some Tibetan word. Some word that refers to something, but it doesn't matter. It is the Dharmakaya, the wide open center, the wide open center of the luminous heart. So the luminous heart is the wide open center. It is evinced by whatever arises as creativity. At its point of inception, without base or creator. At its point of inception, without base or creator. What does arise, being mere label, vanishes into spaciousness when identified. What does arise, being mere label, vanishes into spaciousness when identified, assimilated into undifferentiated, virginal sameness, assimilated into undifferentiated, virginal sameness, free of perceptual duality. It is the matrix of spaced out smoothness. This zero-dimensional reality of self-sprung awareness in the now, revealed by analogy, well-defined similitude, evocation, and evidence, the very essence denoted by these three beautiful sky bolts. Assimilates everything without differentiation or exclusion. Assimilates everything without differentiation or exclusion. Assimilates everything. Assimilates everything without differentiation or exclusion. In the womb-like space of this vast expanse of equality. In the now, everything is always the same. In the now, everything is always the same. Without temporal or qualitative distinction. Without temporal or qualitative distinction. This is the vision of the Samantabhadra Vajrasattva. Without temporal or qualitative distinction, and I would also say without locational praxis, without locational distinction, without temporal, without locational, without qualitative distinction, no qualities, I guess that's all inclusive, without temporal or qualitative distinction, without temporal or qualitative distinction, without qualitative distinction, without qualitative distinction, without qualitative distinction, luminous mind is like the solar nucleus. Its nature is clear light. Its nature is clear light. Forever uncompounded. Forever uncompounded. Nothing can veil its translucent spontaneity. Nothing can veil its translucent spontaneity. Nothing can veil its translucent spontaneity. And as unthought reality, elaborate variation is impossible. As unthought reality, elaborate variation is impossible. The Dharmakaya as emptiness, the Sambhoga Kaya, the Sambhoga Kaya as clarity, and the Nirmana Kaya as radiance are the three kayas. Yet they can never be united or separated. Yet they can never be united or separated. And since in the now their potential is wrought in spontaneity, their potential is wrought in spontaneity. In the now, their potential is wrought in spontaneity. Darkening flaws and faults cannot veil them. Darkening flaws and faults cannot veil them. The emptiness, the clarity, and the radiance, the three kayas. Darkening flaws and faults cannot veil them. Very important. Darkening thought, flaws, and faults cannot veil them. They are identical in their changelessness and timelessness. Identical in their saturation of Buddhas and sentient beings alike. Identical in their saturation of Buddhas and sentient beings alike. Identical as self-sprung luminous mind. The creativity of that luminous mind occurs as any damn thing, as thought or non-thought, as manifestations or potential, as diverse and various as living beings' perceptions. Things appear, but they never crystallize. Things appear, but they never crystallize. Everything is like mirage, dream, echo. Like apparition, reflection in water and castles in the sky. Like hallucination, things are clearly apparent, but do not truly exist. Know all experience as rootless and baseless. Mere adventitious appearance. Know all experience as rootless and baseless. Mere adventitious experience. Just ephemeral occurrence. Circumstantial and contingent. just ephemeral occurrence, circumstantial and contingent. Just ephemeral appearance, circumstantial and contingent. In the spontaneous nature of luminous mind, the display non-crystallizing, samsara and nirvana emanate magically to be assimilated simultaneously into its spaciousness, to be assimilated simultaneously. Okay. The display non-crystallizing, samsara and nirvana emanate magically to be assimilated simultaneously into its spaciousness. Know that display does not stray from its original natural perfection. Know that display does not stray from its original natural perfection. Know that display does not stray from its original natural perfection. Here and now, everything lies within the scope of luminous mind. Here and now, everything lies within the scope of luminous mind. Perfect in its oneness, perfect in its oneness, perfect in its all-inclusiveness. Everything perfect in its natural, uncontrived reality. As perfection, it is self-sprung awareness in the now. Again, here and now, everything lies within the scope of luminous mind, perfect in its oneness, perfect in its all-inclusiveness, everything perfect in its natural, uncontrived reality. As perfection, it is self-sprung awareness in the now. Since luminous mind is neither visible nor invisible, neither outer nor inner, samsara nor nirvana can exist concretely. Since luminous mind is neither visible nor invisible, neither outer nor inner, samsara nor nirvana can exist concretely. Yet by virtue of its dynamic creativity, the myriad display, the material and spiritual dimensions, samsara and nirvana shine out. Forms that at their very inception are essentially empty, unborn, but appearing to be born. Unborn, but appearing to be born. Unborn, but appearing to be born. Appear, yet nothing whatsoever has been created. Again, forms that at their very inception are essentially empty, unborn, but appearing to be born. Appear, yet nothing whatsoever has been created. Yet nothing whatsoever has been created. Yet nothing whatsoever has been created. Nothing crystallizes. Nothing crystallizes, although it may appear to do so. And that non-crystallizing illusion is the form of emptiness. That non-crystallizing illusion is the form of emptiness. Even in its apparent stability, nothing real subsists. Even in its apparent stability, nothing real subsists. For groundless and changeless, whatever appears. For groundless and changeless, whatever appears. And however it appears, it can never be substantiated. And however it appears, it can never be substantiated. And so it is labeled merely insubstantial. It is labeled merely insubstantial. forces appear by themselves in creativity. They are said symbolically to be synchronicious. Synchronicious. They are said to be symbolically to be synchronicious. They are said symbolically to be synchronicious. Arising in creativity at the very moment of inception. No arising or non-arising can be said to occur. Arising in creativity at the very moment of inception, no arising or non-arising can be said to occur. No time or space. Arising in creativity at the very moment of inception, no arising or non-arising can be said to occur, no time or space. So, quote-unquote, creativity is a mere symbol word designating nothing. So, quote-unquote, creativity is a mere symbol word designating nothing. Since nothing neither alters nor sublimates, since nothing neither alters nor sublimates, how can it move an iota out of luminous mind? How can it move an iota out of luminous mind? Since nothing neither alters nor sublimates, how can it move an iota out of luminous mind? Okay. You see, that wasn't so bad. Full stop in hearing, full stop in hearing, full stop in the now, full stop in the burn. Now, this is medicine. The potency is there. It's like you're taking medicine, and when you take the Advil or whatever, you take the medicine, the potency is there. It's in the medicine. It's just a matter of taking the medicine. This is what we're doing, is we're taking the medicine. It's necessary medicine. And of course, the self-righteous claim, I want stronger medicine than that. That stuff is not strong enough for me. Rationalizing their refusal to do this. This is plenty powerful medicine, right? To reach the goal. We want the medicine that will help, will enable us to reach the goal. We're not trying to pose as who's taking the stronger medicine. That's ridiculous. It's absurd. This medicine is extremely strong. So there's no question about that. This is a very intense dosage. So there's no posturing possible here. It's absurdity. So put that posturing away. Full stop the posturing. And realize you are taking the heavy dosage. This is heavy dosage. Very heavy dosage. And the only reason someone might be saying no to it is that they're not quite accustomed to such heavy dosages, which means they have to practice more and more and more every day, right? And all we have to do is sit full stop in the now. We don't need to understand, agree or disagree, get it or not get it. The medicine works automatically. So, what we're doing, we're taking our medicine. This is just the basics. A repentant mind, spirit, takes this medicine. Once one repents, once I repented, I've never taken a day off. Daily medicine. It's like a, you know, diabetic or taking insulin or so someone who needs a medicine to survive the body, to continue on. I take it every day. claim me well. I don't need this medicine. I only need it just occasionally. They're unrepentant. That's the unrepentant. That's the self-righteousness, self-righteous rationalization of continuity fear. That's all it is. Severe continuity fear. Refusing to admit that it needs to be evaporated. Thinking that, hoping it's impossible. And so saying, oh sure, I would do spiritual practice, except that I don't need to yet. You know, something like that. A repentant mind realizes we have a severe continuity problem. We have to evaporate, and only the daily effort is the medicine that we must take. Daily effort. Daily medicine. Because, of course, what was just said by Longchenpa is a total mind blower, isn't it? Total mind blower. Blowing the cobwebs out of our mind. We've taken these cobwebs to be the structure of mind. And when we see these cobwebs blowing away, we say, whoa, I'm going to lose the structure of absurdity, which we think is life. As if contrast were life. And what Longchenpa just pointed out is that contrast is most, no such thing as contrast. So as these cobwebs, this structure, this mirage-like structure, it is melting away, blown away like cobwebs. We're just thinking like, wow. When we say, who am I? What am I? We're saying, what is determinant? We're asking, okay, where's the determinant here? Where's the determinant? There is no determinant. There's contrast. We think there's contrast, but that's mere label also, actually. There's nothing that's determinant. So we don't need to seek for it. Really advanced ones are the ones that are doing this. Full stop in the burn, full stop in hearing, full stop in now, full stop in the burn. Those are the ones that are taking their medicine, heavy medicine. That's curing the situation, actually. They may not appear to be as, you know, like the posers. The posers can appear to be very advanced and talk a great talk. It's easy to talk a great talk. Easy. Actors can speak their lines very convincingly, right? Easy. And there are many, the world is full of those like that. Many. Nothing's happening there. There's no medicine being taken. They're delaying it. They're saying, well, as soon as I get finished explaining truth, then I'll take my medicine. And they never get around to taking it. So Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit, they shall inherit the kingdom. What he's speaking to is this, pick up your cross. If you know that you have a severe continuity problem, if you know that you're lost, if you've been lost in this delusional belief in forces that are structural forces, time, space, process, look, form, duration and location. Imagining qualities, attributes, forces that God did not create. This is sin. We've been lost in a dream of sin, a sinful dream. And this is delusion. So we have a severe continuity problem where we're afraid to wake up because we think we won't have any structure. Well, we have oneness. Oneness is quote unquote. Totality is the structure of totality. There is no other structure, that's it. And so we're going through the ordeal of preparation, the ordeal of the burn, the ordeal of preparation here. And so we seem like we're struggling. We seem like, wow, I can barely function, I can hardly talk, I just can't, you know. We don't have to pretend to that we're somehow anything other than going through an ordeal. We don't need to pretend we're doing anything other than going through an ordeal. Why would an outlet of truth such as Longchenpa, why would Longchenpa respond to my prayers? I made it just an open-ended invitation. No qualifications whatsoever. Whatever help that can truly help. Please arrive right now. We need it. Whatever it is, I'm not putting any qualifications. Just open-ended, wide open invitation from my heart, just saying, help. You know, this situation, the world of absurdity, getting more and more intense about the structuring of absurdity. That is absurdity. So absurdity is getting more and more intense here. I said, this is getting too intense, please, whatever. So someone showed up. That in the indications are it's Longchenpa, Longchen Rabjampa, who I didn't know. I didn't put any qualifications of who it has to be at all. So someone shows up. And says, here, try this out. See if this medicine is suitable for you. And I said, wow, this is really strong medicine. Really strong medicine. Phase 4. This is phase 4 medicine. That Longchenpa is bringing phase 4 medicine. Course in Miracles was phase 2 medicine. Bible is phase 1 medicine. Course in Miracles, phase 2. Journey Beyond Words, phase 3 medicine. This Longchenpa's precious treasury of the Dharma Dhatu, the radical Dzogchen of the Vajrahard, spaciousness. This is phase 4 medicine. This is phase 4 medicine. And it's humbling because you think, you know, phase 3, you think, I know it all. I get it. And then phase 4 comes along and you just say, whoa, this is double dosage, double dosing now. Now keep in mind that Longchenpa's teaching of Adi Yoga is designed only for the phase 4, those who are in phase 4. It's not for everyone. The dosage is very strong, it's double dosing. And it requires the capacity to handle this double dosing. So why did Longchenpa respond to my plea? Because he must have discerned that I was able to get into phase 4. That's why this particular outlet of truth showed up, is having the phase 4 material, being an expert on phase 4, which leads to phase 5, which is actually relaxing in the totality, as the totality, and nothing more than that. He's an expert at it. That's why he showed up. He's an expert. I didn't ask for phase 4 help. I just asked for whatever help that is proper for where we're at right now. Please, we need it right now. Showed up. So credit where credit is due. Those who show up, you know, deserve the credit for sure. Deserve, and what does credit mean? Attention. Deserve the attention. The doctor shows up and says, okay, now I'm going to give you a double dose. Says, don't worry, I will make sure that everything goes fine, but you need the double dose now. And this is true. We're at September 9/11, 2/14, 13th anniversary of 9/11, which really changed the direction of this world, or accelerated the direction it was already going in, towards a vast, top-down, all-controlling, bureaucratic, totalitarian regime of extreme control. I call it the Big Mother, with the pharmaceutical companies. And all of this has been accelerated and is now going to be drastically double-dosed itself, you see. This is what I've been warning about, is this acceleration towards a hive mind, bureaucratic, top-down hive mind, bureaucratic totalitarianism of absolute control, of insisting that confusion continue to be applied to confusion, that absurdity continue to be applied to absurdity, which is really an expression of the continuity fear unrecognized. Okay, it's really an expression of the expressiveness of the continuity fear unrealized, in that one is terrified to think outside the box, for instance, to start taking their medicine and begin to awaken from this lunacy, this absurdity. They're so frightened of this, they have to have absolute control over everyone's very thoughts and actions. So nothing, no turning towards truth happens anywhere. That's how severely frightened they are. And their goal is to exterminate any possibility of turning towards truth, is to control everyone so no one is doing what we have just are doing. Okay. Doesn't want anyone to do that on the whole face, the whole planet. It's worshiping nature. It's believing in nature. It's believing in that happiness comes from harmony with nature. Okay, this is pagan absurdity, which is an expression of continuity fear unrecognized and a non-repentant spirit that is still pridefully trying to be happy in a separate creation based on a foundation of chaos. And there's actually no foundation at all. The true foundation is simply the oneness, the totality. This is just an imaginary foundation, a contrasting, as it were, of appearancing. A belief that appearances have meaning in contrast, not true. So this drive towards the big mother bureaucratic state, which is, of course, being marketed very cleverly. They take the fairest faces possible and say, look how happy you're going to be as you, and of course, Big Mother represents nature. If everyone being having body being born, Mother represents the protection, the good side of nature, the protective nature. Nature as protective and nurturing and all this. So, it represents, we're going towards pleasing nature, pleasing Mother, being in harmony with Mother, being in harmony with what? Mother Nature, ultimately. This is the path of salvation through works. This is the path of delusion, severe delusion, continuity fear unrecognized, repentance rejected. Okay, it's futile. It's absolutely futile and fruitless. But this is where we're at, that the world is ready now to double dose, to double dose, to double dose on this big mother bureaucracy, where the mantra is, Mother is always right. Mother is always right. And that Mother intuitively knows what is harmonious with nature and what is out of harmony with nature. So therefore, Mother becomes the all-knowing oracle of what is right to do. And all bureaucracy takes its legitimacy and authority from worshiping the all-knowing oracle of the Mother, who supposedly is in tune with supposed nature. There is no nature. There's nothing to be in tune with as far as nature goes. It doesn't exist. It's a dream. It's a hallucination. It's a fantasy. It's a misinterpretation. It's spiritual pride. It's a desire to be separate from God, create a separate reality. And yet none of that exists at all. So, as this situation trickling through society, as we're feeling it everywhere we turn now, we get this feeling like Mother is always right. We must not go against whatever Mother says, quote unquote Mother. Now Mother can be represented by all these winsome maidens, fair-faced welcomers to the new age, you know. And of course they say, we're here, don't worry, we're here, we'll be here for you, and we'll be the oracles for you, the priestesses, and we'll tell you exactly how to get in tune with nature and how to stay in tune with nature. Of course we'll say that. That's what they're how they're marketing it. Structure whatsoever is completely formless. It's, as Nongchenpa says, all appearances, apparent appearances, have emptiness as their form. are an expression of the form of emptiness. How can emptiness have structure? And yet it's apparent, it appears all this, right? It's a very clever hallucination. It's a very clever hallucination. But salvation through grace is the only way, which is simply relaxing into the natural state, the natural totality of all that is, the oneness, and realizing that's all that there's ever been. We've never been born. Nothing has ever been born. Nothing has ever crystallized. There's never been any crystallization. Never will. There's never been a world. There's never been nature. Never existed. So how can you get in harmony with that? You cannot. You cannot. There's only a sense of fear, of disharmony, and a structuring of what is supposed harmony and disharmony. And you end up living as a slave to this bureaucratic apparatus, which derives its legitimacy from the oracle of the Great Mother archetype. And this is already super apparent in the consciousness of this planet. This consciousness is obsessed with asserting that Mother is always right, that there are never two sides to the issue whatsoever. Never two sides to the issue whatsoever. That there is only one side to it, and that's Mother's side. So the big Mother, the all-inclusive Mother, meaning the whole motherness, femaleness, womanness, motherness, who supposedly is inherently in tune with nature, Mother Nature, inherently so, and must know the truth, and therefore everybody must listen. There's no two sides to it. The planet has been indoctrinated in this, but it's doubling down now, more and more and more and more intense. All of this is contrived, actually. It's all a contrivance. Everything that happens here is a contrivance in terms of supporting this agenda of salvation through works. It's all a contrivance. It's all a scam. It's a contrivance. Jesus is the one that points this out most clearly, I would say. Jesus is willing to take on these very controversial issues about victimization and all this, and guilt, and says it's a contrivance. It's a total agreement. It is a contrivance. It's a setup to usher in the belief that there's some right side, a right and a wrong to what? See, it's playing like a god, a new god. It's playing the goddess, actually, the role of the goddess. There is no goddess. There's only the totality, as Longchenpa points out. There's no goddess of nature. There is no nature. And yet, those who believe there is will believe that there must, they believe they have to get in harmony with it somehow. And so they feel they must be out of in disharmony. Our disharmony is impossible, but in reality, disharmony is impossible. There's no such notion whatsoever, as Longchenpa so beautifully would have just pointed out. And we may have forgotten, that's okay, we've forgotten the words, but the hearing is still with us. The hearing is still with us. The medicine is still having its effect. So as the consciousness doubles down on absurdity, doubles down on the goddess, doubles down on the priestesses, the goddesses, deriving legitimacy supposedly from the Great Mother, who understands, is in tune with Mother Nature, as we pursue salvation through works, we go down the rabbit hole of absurdity and fanaticism and repression and tyranny, more and more and more and more and more. A type of spiritual darkness takes place, where we apply confusion to confusion, where we're merely posers, spiritual posers, insisting that we're merely preparing for the true Savior to come, and that's why we're not paying attention to, you know, truth. So no, we're getting ourselves ready for eventually. No, they always say that. We're doing it right here, right now. We're not waiting for anything. There's nothing to wait for. There's no harmony to wait for. There's nothing to wait for, actually. There's absolutely nothing to wait for. And this sinks in and sinks in and sinks in. And you begin to get some genuine authenticity begins to arise. The citadel of authenticity begins to arise in your nature, as it were. The unassailable citadel of authenticity. The unassailable citadel of authenticity begins to arise naturally as we take this medicine. And we have no advice for those who follow the path of works, salvation through works, except to repent. That's the only advice I have, is to repent. Repent, and then you will know what to do. Repent, and then you will know. Daily efforts to evaporate the continuity fear are what you will do. You will automatically do that. That's the only advice there is. That's the only advice that can be given them. Anything else is only seen as structural advice to be argued over, discussed, as if you're talking to someone who's equally sane. Since it's on the level of words, it's easy for everybody to feel equal on the level of words, as far as, you know, equally competent, equally not having continuity fear, which is delusional, pragmatically delusional. Everyone is at a different place in the amount of continuity fear that they have. But because words are used, it's easy to think you're on the same place as far as continuity fear goes, which is not true. It's not true. For instance, I can use the words of Longchenpa here, but does that mean I'm in the same level of continuity, lack of continuity fear as Longchenpa? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. I still have severe continuity fear. Longchenpa has none. But as severe as the continuity fear is, having repented, I'm able to evaporate it. And there's a confidence in this evaporation. So I do have faith and certitude that this works. So that's why I'm able to transmit these words also, pass them on, to help transmit them, even though I still have severe continuity fear. It's acknowledged. It's thoroughly acknowledged and looked into. And spiritual will is active. It's for full stopping. So those are the fruits of repentance. The fruits of repentance make it possible for someone to use words and help out, even though they still have continuity fear, still an issue, severe issue. Whereas the unrepentant, they will say, well, I can use those words too. He says, yeah, but you're not really transmitting them. You're not really amplifying and transmitting them. You're not transmitting them to be heard. See, they're not transmitting this to be heard. They're transmitting it to pose. Pose is not needing the medicine. Do not go through the ordeal. They want to escape that ordeal. There's no escape from that ordeal. You've got to take your medicine. Might as well start. Christianity, the whole theme of Christianity, take up your cross. You have to carry your cross. You have to start. You might as well start. Christianity is all about phase one, get started. Get started. This is the great mission of Christianity. Get started. So it's primarily focused on phase one, Christianity. So of course some sophisticates will scoff at it and think they're superior, but you know, you need phase one. Phase one, once begun, is half done. So really Christianity gets you halfway there. At least phase one gets you halfway there. Gets you started. And it's the same with other traditions. They have the phase one too. But Christianity is more rooted in phase one. Whereas some other traditions seem to be more rooted in phase two or three. But there are no traditions that are rooted in phase four. No traditions are actually rooted in phase four. No large tradition, certainly. No, it's rootless and baseless, and it arises as the cream arises to the top. Once one has gone through phase one, phase two, phase three, so in phase four, you feel sort of like a maverick, and that you're not really rooted. I mean, this Ati Yoga teaching is not really rooted in Buddhist tradition so much. In gradualism. In fact, it rejects it, gradualism, and has been persecuted by Buddhism for a long time, actually. It's not really rooted in Christianity. Is not rooted in any tradition, actually. And yet it contains phase one, phase two, and phase three. It contains all of that, actually. It contains all of it. So of course, those who have a very severe continuity problem, who've been working on trying to structuring absurdity, which is absurdity, for a long time, they are very unrepentant. They're very, very resistant to repentance. And so they hate religion. They have religiophobia. Religiophobia. They're religiophobic. And actually being religiophobic is the most extreme phobia there is. Because what it really means is they're afraid to repent. They're afraid to work on their continuity fear because they believe it's so severe it can't be cured. So all these people, these posers, these secular humanist posers, what they're really saying is that they're so scared they can never be cured, right? They're so confused they can never be clarified. And this is like their claim to greatness. It's like we're so poor, we're great. We're so miserable, we're great. We're so incurable that we're somehow awesome. Let's celebrate our incurability. You know, this is the mania in the world. Let's celebrate our incurability. This is what we have. The inmates running the asylum. The inmates say, hey, we know a cure. We just claim we're incurable and celebrate it. Yeah, that's absurdity. Absurdity celebrating absurdity we have in the world now. So this religiophobia is such a incredible phobia that it, an attempt to avoid it, they come up with all other phobias and are trying telling everybody else how phobic they are, you know, about other stuff. You know, you're bigoted, you're phobic, you're this. These are the people who are suffering from an extreme religiophobia, extreme. So I say, let them clear up the religiophobia first and then see what other phobias are still there. This is the only advice you can give. In other words, let them repent. Religions call everyone to repent. You can either answer the call or not. But don't say the call isn't being made. The refusal to do so is simply, one is still running on the fumes of spiritual pride. We're very prideful. We're very prideful. We think that we have the capacity to be greater than God. And it takes a while for us to be humbled and saying, wow, so, you know, something's wrong. I don't like this. And then to admit that God must be able to help is another very important. Repentance means you trust that God has a way to clear up this continuity fear, and God certainly does. But it takes a while. It takes a while. Many in this world are not displaying the temperament, the attitude that they're willing to accept repentance, to repent. Very, doesn't seem like that's in vogue during this phase. So we have a religiophobic world right now, very heavily religiophobic. Trying to justify that phobia, of course, they're trying to rationalize it any way they can possibly try to rationalize. They're relentless in their effort to rationalize their religiophobia, which is based on ignorance, bigotry, intolerance, you know, prejudice. Religiophobia is based on all that. It's actually based on a great dread, a great fear, a great spiritual pride, confusion, absurdity. It's based on all of that. And they're busy, you know, avoiding facing themselves and looking in the mirror, telling everybody else to look in the mirror. They're the ones who have the problems. Those who have repented have problems, sure. They actually have one problem, a continuity problem. But at least they're working on it. They're taking the medicine. They may be taking little doses. In phase one, you take little doses, okay? But that gets you started in the habit of taking the medicine. That's the best habit there is. Spiritual medicine, not pharmaceutical medicine. That's right, pharmaceutical. Instead of pharma, pharmaceutical. The pharmaceutical companies, they say, hey, we know you want to take your medicine. We'll give you the medicine, and you won't have to suffer the full stop. You won't have to even suffer the ordeal, go through the ordeal. In other words, you get to be lazy. Pharmaceuticals companies are pushing laziness, spiritual laziness on the world. And of course, those who are terrified of the unrepentant and supremely suffering from this extreme religiophobia, they love the pharmaceuticals. Oh, it's just, oh God, this is what we want. Thank God for the pharmaceutical firms. More, more, more. They say, more, more, more. This is what we want. We don't want the ordeal. It'll be too much for us. You know, we're too messed up. We're too confused. We can never get unconfused. To suggest that we can is like torture to us. We don't want to even hear it. This is the unrepentant ones. And nobody says it's easy. Nobody says the spiritual path is easy. Nobody said taking your medicine, daily medicine, is easy. But we also say it's absolutely unavoidable. So it's not negotiable at all. It's totally non-negotiable. Repentance is totally non-negotiable. It's an absolute. We have to relinquish our delusional beliefs. And to do so automatically entails the jitters, continuity fear jitters. So we have no choice but to repent. That's a non-negotiable, absolute, from God, from totality, from reality, from what we are. We cannot change that. It doesn't matter how long we try to change it. It will still be an absolute requirement. For everyone, no exceptions, no exceptions, not even from big exceptions for Big Mother, not even for all the oracle priestesses, no exception. They must repent. There's no exception for anyone. It's an absolute, non-negotiable, absolute fact. And so we're not doing anybody any favors by suggesting otherwise. So we're not doing any favors by going along with the Big Mother bureaucracy. It's not helpful for them. It's not helpful for them. If we cannot keep expressing truth in this world, then perhaps we will need to do something.